Hey everyone, the Black Queen here with another episode of Queen Reacts, and today I'm going to be getting to Little Shy FIM's Cinemarisons videos. This is episodes 3 through 12, I think, of season 5. I'm finally getting back to this because it's been way too long. I'm finally going to be catching up on some videos, as I said in the last one, which was my reactions to Friendship is Randomly Music video 1 through 3.5. By the way, my volume of the video was a lot louder on that video, so it's kind of hard to hear me, I just realized, so I'm gonna have this one turned down a little bit more, so hopefully you can hear things that I'm saying, at least, because that was really loud. I didn't expect it to be that loud. I'm just gonna adjust some speakers. Alright. So yeah, we have Castle Sweet Castle. It was a pretty good episode. What was after that? Bloom and Gloom? I think that was a good episode. I forget what it was about. It had Tender Taps in it. I think that's his name. That's the tap dancing kid. After that, I forget. Here, I'm just gonna pull it up very quick. It should be up here soon. Bum 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 bum. Alright. 5 is Tanks for the Memories, which is a really good episode. That was a fantastic episode. Appaloosa's Most Wanted, that was an okay episode, I'd say. Make New Friends But Keep Discord, that was a fun episode. Everything Wrong with the Lost Treasure of Griffinstone. Yeah, that was a great episode. And, of course, Slice of Life. That's gonna be fun. And it's 8 minutes long, so I'm pretty sure he has a lot to say in this one. Yeah. Princess Spike. The first bad episode of the season, in my opinion, at least. But I think a lot of people would agree with that. And then Party Pooped, which is another kind of bad episode. The yaks were really annoying when they first came in. They're still kind of annoying now, but I guess it's gone down. And then Everything Wrong with Amending Fences, which is another fantastic episode, and then I'd be caught up. So, yeah. 10 great episodes and 2 meh episodes. I think it's 10. I think I'm doing 12. Actually, no. I'm doing 9. Okay, 9. There's Castle Sea Castle, Bloom and Gloom, Tanks for the Memories, Appaloosa's Most Wanted, Make Your Friends But Keep Discord, The Lost Treasure of Griffinstone, Slice of Life, Princess Spike, Party Pooped, and then Amending Fences. So I'm doing 10. 2 of those I'd say are bad episodes, and then the rest are fantastic episodes. Or at least good, in between good and fantastic. So I'm rambling on. Let's get right into it, because I'm spending too much time in the intro. Here we go. 3, 2, 1, play. Yeah, this is loud here. Castle to Castle. This is gonna be sad. Actually, no, it's not, because
Twilight forgets that Angel can talk to Fluttershy.
Right.
Apparently, he forgets as well. This one frame demands the return of an old recurring sin.
Oh.
Angel slams the door with the power of his little angry bunny mind. Can you blame Twilight for avoiding this inappropriately shaped castle? Ponyville doesn't need to wait for the rooster to crow when they have the main six.
Rainbow eating those were funny.
In Equestria, saplings are just much smaller versions of the full-size tree.
Wow.
I've been avoiding this place.
Well, in that case, you're doing a terrible job.
Uh-huh.
Why would you want to avoid such a gorgeous castle? This place has everything.
Twilight represents the Brony. The others represents Toys R Us.
Right.
Only one of these two haven't gone bankrupt.
This place has
for a castle episode, it's no surprise the ponies resort to reading the back of the castle toy playset box.
Oh, wow.
Castle is amazing.
It'd be nice to see the memo
directly from the box.
Of course, Twilight to have it both
maybe
ways.
The box took
fine,
it the show.
You can have the purple one trying to avoid the castle, but he has to call it amazing at some point. Twilight's incorrectly mirrored a mirror. That is to say, she isn't. Spike sleeping with a rarity plush, only weird because she's not fictional in this universe. At least that's what I keep telling myself.
Okay.
Wagon has neither hinges nor clasp. Literal toy placement. Rarity's the only pony to contribute something that's not a horrible idea.
Well, yeah,
I
guess.
Cutie Mark, and you can't blame it on the angle because she's doing the same pose here. Applejack could be solving world hunger with this ability, but instead she's instantly growing flowers indoors.
Wow. That's right. Forgot about the newer.
Fun fact, cartoons like this are responsible for all of the world's bear baldings of children.
Okay.
Squirrel appears to be standing on nothing.
Your sparkly window doohickeys, which are... why, they're just swell.
Honest orange apple horse tells a lie. Wow. Everything is pretty much entirely Fluttershy's fault. Fluttershy can tame monsters, but not calm down domesticated pets.
I guess
Dog
maybe.
Better come home. Like, forever? But we live here. Yeah.
Rarity forgets her line and accidentally says yes to them. Spike could fly long before season 8. In his haste to distract Twilight, Spike didn't know what massage he was ordering until this moment. Yet somehow, Aloe and Bulk appeared mere seconds later.
The extra strength hot stone deep tissue massage?
Spike could have just said, oops, I meant a normal one. But instead he says...
yep.
Bulk's hat disappears a moment later.
I really miss this.
Here's the sad
But I don't
sad
miss
part.
It enough to even attempt to bring it back with magic or something.
Well, I don't know if she can.
The Golden Oak Library was hard for you, too.
The only time the library was ever called by name, and it only took its death.
Wow.
Spike is deceptive, even resorts to a form of violence to stall Twilight, which is strange, because it's not like the castle makeover is a secret. He could just say they need more time.
If we could do
that's what I was kind of having a problem with.
In a castle that just makes her feel... sad.
I was just gonna say, we could hire an interior decorator, but okay. Let's just hang up the decaying remains, why don't we? This could have backfired spectacularly if Twilight didn't somehow end up liking the
idea. That would have been terrible.
Also, do you recall Golden Oak Library being so tiny? And even if it is somehow smaller than it used to be, it's still too big to fit inside the castle doors. Did they have a photography pony there at the
Randy
time?
Could have
because
teleported
otherwise,
it.
They're sure to get a cease and desist letter for using episode screenshots. Pinky is standing down here, yet somehow she can reach one of the gems up here.
Oh. That's right.
Dang it, Fluttershy. All right. You better not have put any of your weird My Little Human plushies in there. It's okay, Pinky. You're not the first to have your headcanon explode.
It's not my fault I hid them so well.
The fallacy in that statement is so obvious that she must be referring to the actions of a Mirror Pool clone. Fun fact, Twilight wasn't voiced by Tara Strong in this episode. In fact, Twilight wasn't in this episode at all, according to the credits.
Wow. Maybe Tara Strong was just getting her spa appointment.
We will make this the castle of your dreams. I'm saying this with love, but have you looked in the mirror lately?
Wow.
Whoa. What happened in here? Last I checked, this place was empty.
Oh. Wow. Well, I mean, that's going to be foreshadowing, I think. But for next season, not for this set of episodes. Because I keep forgetting, at this point, Starlight's not reformed. It's kind of weird to go to that point. Everything wrong with Bloomin' Bloom. Oh, wait, no, this wasn't that one I'm thinking of.
She was always fussing with her bangs and tail. Oh, but she grows up to be a celebrity.
Hold on, which episode was this?
Less an indicator
maybe
of interest
this
in
episode
hair,
is actually kind of forgettable
of
if I think
anxiety.
About it.
Can cutie marks misread social cues?
I sure wouldn't want to be up to my flanky
hair
all day.
She was Sweetie having problems.
Do
okay,
you
the
such uncouth language
tap dancing episode
not
was next season?
And what's
or
not to like
season?
About apples? There's core
and sour apples
this
and rotten apples and apples with worms in them.
Your blasphemy is punishable by death.
Yeah.
The real nightmare is this castle.
Those are way too many questions to answer all in one night.
Then too bad, be a better pony, that's life, who cares, no, and here. That was all the answers in a few seconds. It's only because AJ doesn't want to spend a few minutes to deal with this that Applebloom has to experience the forthcoming torment at all. Watching one of the most boring parts of a character's day in order for the dream fake-out to make any sense. Consider this a two-in-one sin for the what and the why. Either Applebloom got her cutie mark while sleeping in underwhelming fashion, or none of this is real at all. Both potentials are sin-worthy. Is this character's convenient entry a sin, or does nothing count as a sin in this episode, since it's all a dream anyway? That kind of sin confusion deserves a sin. Pre-sliced apple.
Oh.
You ever hear of Twitterites?
Boy, this show sure has a thing for Twitters and
Shut
tweets.
The fuck
if one didn't
up.
Know
no
any
one
better,
asked
they might assume
dumb,
there exists a social network by that name, full of annoying fans.
Even it's a reference to the Ponies the Anthology 7 I watched. I'm starting to warm up to that video. I like it. I like
subtle diss
most
against
of
the
beginning
the Apple
ones, though.
Pastures. You know the phrase, pinch me, I must be dreaming? That's because you're not supposed to be able to feel pain in dreams.
Right.
All but this glitter-mite's antenna disappears as it's sucked up.
When you dream, you kind of feel like you think you feel pain. But the fact these two
appear right behind her and also manage to snatch her equipment from mere inches away should clue Appleblum into the fact something's not right.
Look at the new bug pony.
Oh, that's right. Diamond Tiara is still a bitch.
Changeling racial slurs. Silver Spoon's shadow only appears momentarily. How nice of Appleblum's dream to provide this foreshadowing cutaway shot. Inner leg cutie mark and completely broken leg.
Oh, wow.
This anatomy is problematic for a multitude of reasons only a cartoon could get away with. But most importantly, she's an apple to the core.
Yeah.
In Equestria, roosters lay eggs. Okay, yes, dream and all, but that only makes it a sin for Appleblum's lack of noticing these things.
Okay.
A quiet horse whinny can be heard in the background. No doubt some editor pulled up stock farm sounds and didn't think anything wrong with using horse sound effects in a show called My Little Pony.
We both sort of got our cutie marks. What are they?
No.
Oh, we don't have time to go into all of that.
This episode is the ultimate tease.
Yeah.
Okay, at this point, the show has to be making fun of nitpickers on purpose. AJ's hat, Appleblum's blanket, and literally all of the scene's blocking changes between shots. This sin isn't for any of those things, but rather retaliation for an obvious personal attack on nitpicking.
And you're gonna have to change your name.
Your current name infringes upon the Apple family trademark. Cease and desist all Apple family-related activities. The Appleblum of the mirror dimension doesn't blink in sync and almost exposes the conspiracy. This face is highly offensive and should be censored. That's better. You can thank this episode for making socks canon. Get it? Because socks cover cannons? Princess Luna waited off-screen eating popcorn before finally helping
I know that
the
joke.
The ground is clearly not moving during this running shot. Appleblum's bow doesn't cast a shadow because that would have made it too obvious.
Sometimes we can worry about a thing so much the fear can make us feel like we're trapped in a nightmare.
That's all well and nice, Luna, but she literally is trapped in a nightmare, and you didn't answer her question in the slightest.
I must be the only pony in the universe that's worried about her cutie mark.
Well,
Appleblum states something that is obviously not the case, just to set up Luna's response.
Well,
Luna
taking
Appleblum to her friend's dreams is a serious invasion of privacy. Remember when Sweetie Belle was into singing? Her fear of giving up this passion did come true after all. Scootaloo is having a dream where she's literally drowning, yet seconds later in a shared dream, she's completely composed.
We're still asleep? Cool!
Wow.
This is the most heartwarming and heartbreaking moment of the entire show.
I would assume so,
So don't you cry or fret.
Ah, yes. Spontaneous and thematically appropriate singing. This is no dream. This is the real world.
Right.
What are the odds? Applejack says almost the same thing she did in each of the nested dreams. Unless...
Oh.
A good night's sleep cures just about everything.
I just wish it hadn't been so exhausting.
Granny Smith is the only one not confused by that, because she is secretly Princess Luna herself.
Oh!
Appleblum's name is missing its space.
Clever.
Must have been the same space which found its way into Equestria Girls.
Oh. That's mostly what I say, James. Oh and wow.
Why don't I just wake up? Appleblum, what's this all about? Oh, nothing.
Right. Oh? She's glitching, or she's got a virus? Alright, thanks for the memories. With. Wrong. Everything. Derp. Spoilers. Wait, he didn't say dirt.
Am I right?
I just realized.
Controlling the falling of leaves is all nice and well and all, but what about the countless trees across Ponyville which are still green?
You're doing awesome, everypony!
Aside from the fact that these trees are completely unaffected, of course.
We need those leaves off those trees!
Those leaves aren't on those trees.
Yeah, what the hell?
Throughout the episode, Dash is awfully careless around Tank's spinning propellers.
Yeah.
Rainbow Dash yells without opening her mouth.
And over there, we can play horse hockey.
Language, Dash.
Oh.
With no shoulder or rump pads.
Suggesting the lack of padding makes it more extreme, but no pony else wears it, so why the mention at all? Also, rump padding probably doesn't mean what she thinks it means. Tank survives this. Peeling eyelid. Rabbits don't hibernate. Neither do squirrels. Either it's a sin for misinforming viewers, or it's a sin for Fluttershy buying her encyclopedias from the Flim Flam Brothers.
A real reptile expert. I'm a dragon.
The only thing keeping dragons from being classified as reptiles is the fact dragons are not real. Congrats, Spike, you played yourself. Rarity steals her hat designs from adult cartoons. Animator has never moved leaves
That's
before.
Copyright.
Ponies manually put up dangerous icicles, because it's not truly winter until you get a few ice-related injuries. I guess I take the loan shark approach to snowfall. Just beat the snow out of those clouds. On that note, is there much of a difference between that and cloud busting? These clouds should be turning into snow.
When life gives you lemons, you can
That's actually a good point. So they're gonna make tank. Yeah.
Congratulations, Dash. You've doomed these poor birds. Also, if this is north, then Canterlot is missing.
That's not how birds work.
Small for this. Must be the seasonal hires.
They line up with
the
magnetic field.
Two of them are wearing even more clothing now. Dash's rainbow would be a suitable transition if it wasn't for this one extra frame turning it into a jump cut.
Wow.
Anyone viewing this musical solo from the ground is basically watching Dash loudly confess her crimes. If this belt is tight enough to lift Tank, it should not be loose enough to slip a carabiner on so easily. Dash uses no-clip sheets. Of all the things Rainbow Dash considers sabotaging, none of them involve changing the temperature to halt hibernation.
With no water,
that probably could have been easier, but maybe it's difficult.
Water isn't used for anything else that's important, right? Wind becomes irritated at Tank's failure to knock first. Whoever designed the storage of lightning to be glass jars is really the anarchist at fault here.
Oh.
Winter is coming.
Twilight is so eager to reference her favorite fantasy drama that she mistakes lightning bolts for winter.
Obligatory screen.
The motion blur of the snow causes it to disappear momentarily. Even her Tank slippers become progressively sadder over time. Speaking of slippers, Tank reps that merch. This is somehow still legal for unicorns to do. Maybe alicorns are just above the law? Sin either way. Two very long minutes of continuous pony tears. Is this what you wanted to see? Are you not entertained? Don't worry about the ice skaters below. They'll get out of the way.
Probably the saddest moment in the entire... Well, not... No, that's not true. But one of them,
happy to throw away the Ponyville tradition he's previously had an entire episode dedicated to.
I missed that, sorry. I missed what he said.
Tortoises don't hibernate?
Wow. Oh yeah, this is a metaphor of the five stages of grief, isn't it? Wow.
It's okay.
Season 9.
We'll come back in a few months.
Well, I'm already there, and I wish it was longer, simply because I want it to last longer. It's weird. You never really know what you want until you got it, and you realize you don't want it.
See, I'm the fresh casualty of an unusually unfortunate circumstance.
Sliding ground.
Wouldn't a barrel look good here?
Who are you, and what did you do with Scootaloo? This is not an appropriate reaction to have. Life's not a TV show, Apple Bloom. Trouble Shoes likes to carry around his own light source just for important shadow casting occasions, such as this. Suspiciously shaped castle. This not disappears.
He's been a dog's age since I got to compete.
What does the casual use of that idiom say about the expendability of Winona?
Backstage at a rodeo ain't no kind of playground.
Except they've clearly been patronizing the vendors for food and hats. That and the fact there is no backstage here to begin with. Brayburn distracts Applejack to warn her of the things she was just facing toward. That's one versatile sling.
Hey, just happened.
Hey, just happened.
Get it?
Shut down the rodeo.
This voice comes from a mayor. The sheriff stands in the doorway, yet somehow the doors swing through him.
Oh.
He sabotaged the steer pen.
Separating steer from bull is a very disturbing distinction in a world of sentient bovine.
Appaloosa ain't gonna be intimidated.
Immediately following this uplifting scene, Applejack prepares to give up on the rodeo and go home. It's only because of Brayburn's insistence that the episode doesn't end here and now. Looks like we gotta add another adjective for honest orange apple scaredy horse.
Some background noise.
Brayburn's injury swaps between left and right foreleg multiple times. This latch is layered wrong. Not to mention the fact it flips around a moment later.
Yeah.
He's gone feral. Run, Applejack, run. These mismatched cards.
My sister's gone, and her friends, too. He must have been Troubleshoots.
Troubleshoots done a lot of bad things in his day, but nothing like that.
Except, of course, the time he allegedly tried to kill these same three fillies.
Yeah.
The sheriff already believes this, yet he doubts this obvious
also,
connection.
This is kind of dark.
That's right.
Now it's literally dark.
The CMC enter the woods in search of an outlaw, and upon spotting his house, they assume it's abandoned and not the very thing they are looking for. Scootaloo's back-mounted ejector is activated upon foreleg extension. Troubleshoot's convenient arrival seconds after the CMC enter. Somehow he didn't spot them outside. We quickly learn this character's shtick is being cartoonishly clumsy, yet somehow all of the things he breaks weren't already broken.
And some hot cider a-cookin' in the kitchen.
The show doesn't really openly discuss cider like this anymore because of people like me who sit in this scene for resembling alcohol being offered to children.
You can see I'm the fresh casualty of an unusually unfortunate circumstance.
The most unrealistic thing in this cartoon about magical talking ponies is the isolated loner being this well-spoken.
What are you doing?
For all she knows, Scootaloo just questioned why Applebloom would try to run away. In reality, she's helping, but the door is in the same direction.
They weren't laughing at him. They were just enjoying the show.
Something which could be said anytime someone's being laughed at.
So he's been looking at his cutie mark wrong the whole time. It's not bad luck. It's...
Gotcha!
Scootaloo doesn't get to finish, so I'll say it for her. It's proof a cutie mark doesn't need to have anything to do with the talent. Had his mark decided to be clown-related in the first place, Troubleshoots wouldn't have had to spend most of his life tormented by it. Now he'll lie on his deathbed, pondering the years thrown away in isolation, and that he couldn't even figure out the simple solution suggested to him by a child on a whim. How did he manage this lasso? The adults just won't listen, cliche.
Oh, wow.
Worse still, when we're talking about main characters. That is, if you count Braver and
the background.
Sorry,
I sound tired, by the way.
Poor Troubleshoots isn't the maddest every pony thinks!
She said, the next day... Oddly appropriate for the sheriff to take the Apple approach to damaged products. If the mattress is broken, clearly the bed frame needs to be replaced as well. Sweetie Belle levitates the keys, but Applebloom gets the sheriff to exit anyway, so all of that was a pointless risk of getting caught. They're so excited that it drains the color right out of them. The CMC moves so fast they bend the very fabric of reality.
Listen, y'all, I'm a known criminal.
Lawyer, I am not, but that sounded awfully close to a confession. You can hear Applebloom shout, "That's my sister," followed by Sweetie Belle saying, "No, mine." Well,
wow.
That could be a reference to season 2. The real sin is that their mouths don't move.
There, yeah, Mama. That's what I was thinking
how
you were going to say.
Big sis, huh?
Applejack channels her inner Rainbow Dash. The townspeople flip
you mean
from
Ashley
hating
Ball.
Troubleshoots and thinking he's some kind of kidnapping, rodeo-sabotaging terrorist to loving him after only minimal explanation.
We're a lifetime of thinking of it.
Are you glad y'all came with me to see Applejack compete in the Appaloosa Rodeo?
Wow.
Wouldn't the barrel look good here?
Oh. That's something. Next one is make new friends but keep Discord. Let's get it on.
It's a good thing Discord levitates the cup, because how else would Fluttershy pick it up?
Tree hugger?
Don't worry, Discord. Yeah. You get used to it. Rude Castle will never find a plus one with that attitude.
Oh.
It's funny, because he's permanently scarred.
Where's yeah, that's...
She's enchanted by helping Princess Celestia with the gala!
This information is pointless to the episode and goes unused by Discord, because if he did already visit Twilight and Celestia, he'd probably find out that he was indeed already invited to the gala. Cards are face down one moment, then face up the next. Ambiguous card game leads to ambiguous victory. Applejack reacts to Applebloom before we hear the curtain open, which proves Applejack has X-ray vision. Also, Applebloom got dressed behind the curtain because she sure wouldn't want any pony to see her without clothing on. AJ is uncharacteristically
emotional
today.
Well, I mean, like, there is a Discord right there.
In other words, she's crying on the outside. Main Six branded playing
maybe
cards
just looks awkward when you change
close
in public.
To being subliminal host selling, a practice banned in the 90s.
Oh, hi, Discord. Want some cake?
Pinkie Pie's secret video game obsession bears fruit. Oranges, to be specific. She grabs these cakes, but moments later they respawn. Admit it, a periscope was not the first thing you thought of. Does Pinkie sell massive amounts of inventory every day, or do cakes simply not get stale in this universe? Rainbow Dash and or Applejack is trapped in the body of a male pony. A male pony.
Discord or current resident?
Imagine a pony who recently moved and lost their ticket to a new current resident. You'd think such a prestigious event would be more specific than that. They must have forgotten to key out the Smooze's green screen, because everyone knows the real Smooze is purple. Smooze smells so bad it may cause your nostrils to disappear.
Oh.
They shouted, presumably sometime long after their arrival, wooden tankards at a fancy gala. Fluttershy is either giving Discord the cold shoulder, or she's just too mesmerized to look away from those giant eyebrows.
Oh.
The view through the window shouldn't be nothing but
Well, I mean, he has giant eyebrows as well, so...
But even from the ceiling, all of Equestria seems to have disappeared.
That would be a better...
Wear her trademark hat, the hat she loved enough to wear to her friend's wedding for some gala she previously showed disdain toward? Nah, that's too important for such casual wear. Discord appears to forget, then check his lines.
And I'll make sure that the ooze that he can't help but secrete doesn't get on it.
Oh.
This is for not being able to send the electric motor because Discord.
Beg pardon, Rarity, but we don't
normally wear clothes.
Let's just get back to enjoying this magical evening.
Using the word magic to describe a decidedly not magical event in a world where actual magic exists. Disappearing collar and leash. Celestia never was known to keep her valuables in a secure location.
Yeah, what the hell? Why is that a thing?
Discord dims the lights both inside and out, throwing all of Equestria into turmoil.
I've only got these tiny mismatched wings.
Eddie Murphy jacket.
I can fly better than Twilight Sparkle.
Hey!
That moment when your mentor and idol laughs at your expense and your self-confidence takes a permanent hit, leading you to eventually descend from mighty ruler to underpaid teacher, which, story short, is a career choice that gets you trapped in pony hell. All because of this one tragic moment.
What is he doing? I think they're jokes.
Never before with such intensity have I felt the ponies directly speak to me.
Wow.
This episode has a ton of references, but this reference to The Shining has nothing to do with Discord, and therefore is sin for being gratuitous. All of this could have been avoided had Celestia simply not invited Wilhelm.
Yeah.
Trouble follows him wherever he goes.
None of my magic works on this ooze.
She said, after exhausting all two of her spells.
Can you stop it? I'm afraid not.
It's a running joke that Celestia is useless, but at this point it goes beyond joke and into the territory of downright tragedy. Also, this is why royal guards exist. If Celestia isn't capable of protecting herself, then what's the excuse for guards always being absent?
Right.
Don't worry, Fluttershy. We'll stop him.
A few moments later.
More heroes, everyone.
Treehugger. Could you give us a minute?
She said almost exactly 1 minute after talking with Discord.
This has been the most fun gala in years.
I know. It was a
what?
Twilight's surprised because this is the same ending from season one. Anything could happen.
How did she,
as long
how,
as no pony dies, Celestia would be content. Actually, strike that. Celestia will only be content when some pony dies.
Oh. Nothing can.
What is
Oh no, not the leaks.
Gak.
I'm pretty sure this is gonna be the major. Okay. But I remember that was like a big thing. Wow. I'm mumbling a lot today. I don't know. Everything wrong with
Griffin,
the lost treasure of Griffinstone.
Oh,
that's right. This has the rainbow twilight face.
Castle gives us the bird.
Main.
Griffins were known to be rude, insensitive bullies. You mean Gilda?
Attributing harsh generalizations to a group of people.
That is
the impressions of a
that is called racism.
You know, racism.
Yeah.
She was a total jerk to all my friends.
But she's
especially
right though.
Pinkie
Let's be honest, she is right.
The conflict with Gilda actually centered around Fluttershy. A fact this episode never addresses. Episode turns into a slideshow.
Legend says the idol of Boreas was made from the dust of golden sunsets.
Celestia has some splaining to do.
Wow.
It was actually Gilda's visit that made me curious. So I picked up bygone griffins of greatness.
Admittedly, the time in-universe isn't known, but Twilight speaks of this event as if it were yesterday, when it was more than 4.5 years prior, our time.
If the map wanted me to go to the coolest kingdom in all of Equestria...
Good thing Cadence isn't in the room to hear that. Not only do the train's wheels inherently balance precariously, but the back wheels aren't even on the rails.
What you reading, Rainbow?
It took this long for that line to happen. Dash's right wing is no more. It's unsettling when characters
reading
imitate
Rainbow.
Each other, because we all know the animator copied and pasted Twilight's mane, then changed the colors, meaning this actually is Twilight's mane. Pinky is what the train industry wow. likes to call a whale.
Tell the king you've been sent by the Princess of Friendship.
A title which is utterly meaningless and probably even off-putting to this culture.
It's a little known secret
right.
that if you befriend a librarian...
Remember when Twilight was a librarian? Remember when she lived in a library? And now we're all sad.
Right.
What are you doing here?
Gilda responds
She lives
happily.
Here.
I'm a griffin. What's your excuse?
But Dash's dumb question can't go unsaid.
Typical pony hero complex.
This truly was the height of the show. A time when sins were written for us.
We're gonna find that treasure, make Griffin's Stone cool again.
Rainbow Dash 2020, make Equestria
wow.
cool again. Slapstick disguises
all right.
that Dash was somehow
I'll
carrying the book
that.
Around this whole time. Pinky's just trying to cheer up an episode involving a surprising amount of death. There is a story behind every sign. My headcanon is the town wasn't destroyed before the last musical number, retroactively ruining this smile song. Now you'll think
oh.
of this frame whenever you hear it. You're welcome. Silhouettes in a perfectly lit environment. We see Dash at the very edge. Then we go back to Pinky and Gilda. Then, when we return to Dash, it's as if she's approaching the edge for the first time. Oven mitts further complicate hoof grip explanations. The granular jamming theory is now disproved. Back to the drawing board, everyone. Griffin Brake Checker had it coming.
You may act like a gruff grumbling griffin, but inside you're gracious and great.
Sometimes writer credits are really ruthlessly redundant.
Throw me another rope!
You got bits?
Wow.
If lawyers existed, this situation would be resolved at the mere suggestion of negligent rope maintenance. Rainbow Dash's unfinished help sounds more like she's shouting PG profanity. Dash was
wow.
sure to carry along bandages because at this point it would be more surprising if she didn't get hurt while trapped in a crevice. There is no reason why Dash shouldn't be able to ride these currents up and out to safety other than plot convenience.
And you are... Gilda? You sure about that?
Obviously cut joke was cut, obviously. We all know Dash responded with, Are you sure about that, Gilda?
Are you sure about that?
You
know what I'm referencing. Oh.
The loss of immersion is immeasurable, and my day is ruined. Pinky's lack of a brain kills herself and two friends. The rest of the skeleton is conveniently absent, implying an even more violent death involving decapitation.
The Idol of Boreas!
Yes, because that's going to help a lot right now. Had Gilda not reached for the idol this very moment, she could have both saved the ponies and taken it home to restore the kingdom and potentially become queen. But no,
oh.
a binary decision is required here, because cartoon. Remember, kids, tying a rope around your waist is no substitute for a proper harness, lest you be folded
yeah.
in half by your own weight. This is the most we see of Gilda pulling them back up because of how much unrealistic strength she'd need. Replacing a griffin's love for
gold with
baked
goods isn't friendship. It's also really creepy
that there's
a gigantic skull right there.
It's merely a currency exchange,
especially with the silhouette, it makes it creepier.
This cutaway joke freezes unnaturally to allow the background jingle to finish.
Wow.
See you later, you old charmer.
Pinky's unhealthy fascination with this statue.
Yeah. What was with that? And there's that face again. Friendship is religion.
Who's with that? Griffinstone needs fewer ponies.
Racism. That's more of a mic drop because she dropped something in her hand, claw, when she said that. Next is Slice of Life. This ought to be good. This is going to be 8 minutes. This is going to be great. Here we go. Nothing wrong with slice of mine in 8 minutes or less.
These photos tell a story. Cranky with Matilda, cranky with Matilda, smiling without Matilda.
Oh.
This photo in particular tells the story of beverage drinking futility. Because they can't pick these up with hooves, but also, who leaves drinks on the floor?
Also, what's with the smoke?
Offensive
like
bucktooth emoji sticker. Being offensive isn't the sin, but rather the existence of emoji.
Oh.
This glue stick.
Yeah.
You may be expecting a horse's
That's what I was trying to say.
For borderline trademark infringement.
That's like literally
this envelope
it.
Teleports. Phantom
Both
page
glue
appears
and
only glue. Momentarily. Redacted wedding invitation.
Derpy, 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 derpy.
Back in October 2010, episode 1 aired, and it happened to feature a background pony.
Here we go.
Fans quickly became attached and dubbed her Derpy, giving her a muffin-loving personality. It just so happened the show had plans to introduce a ditzy character of its own, but after seeing fan reaction to this background oddity, they made Derpy the new ditzy. As fan appreciation grew, Derpy made her first vocal appearance in season 2's The Last Roundup, but unfortunately, due to mistaken voice direction, legal issues, overbearing political correctness, Derpy was censored in future airings of the episode, which caused fan outrage and inspired a movement rallying around her. It was largely due to this immense support
this
that we saw
in
return
Derpy.
Later episodes, but it was this appearance here, which is the culmination of over half a decade of fan support, that we finally see and hear Derpy in all her wall-eyed, muffin-loving glory. Maybe the castle's
not
so bad.
That's only taking off one sin?
It did bring us these middle finger jokes after all. Dr. Hooves is another background pony early bronies became attached to, giving him the headcanon of being the doctor from
Dr.
Hooves.
Going to be
this
going
episode
into the
clearly runs
That'd
with that concept as he talks about time travel, has an appropriate accent, wears a bow tie, the fourth doctor's scarf, and even shouts the long-running catchphrase. Dr. Hooves and Derpy being a pair was originally popularized by Ball Dumbo Rat's Tumblr
right,
blog
I think I heard
and
of that.
Animations from Orcarina Player.
In that.
Derpy doing something adorable that will be gift for all eternity.
Uh-huh.
Electrified nose boob puts the fandom's booping ingenuity to shame.
Oh.
Final Scratch, a.k.a. DJ Pone 3, is another fan-favorite background pony, which
is
originally
going to
had
the
a
negatives.
5-second appearance in Season 1, suited for success, and just like Derpy, fans quickly came up with a mountain of characterization, much of which is represented here. These bowlers are a reference to Season 2's The Cutie Pox, which in turn was a reference to a long-running joke from show Lauren and her husband worked on, which in turn was a reference to one of their favorite movies, The Big Lebowski. That makes this a reference to a reference which
to,
is a
which
reference.
Okay.
This rug I have, it really ties
So is it
going to
be a sin or take off a sin?
Naked?
Okay.
Man.
This episode addresses what would have otherwise been a sin, and it is glorious. Regardless, we have to roll the clip. Octavia is, you guessed it,
yeah.
Another popular background pony. She first appeared for a couple seconds in the season 1 finale and was quickly characterized by fans as a posh cellist with an accent popularized by fan voices. Much like Vinyl Scratch, the fan voice became so ingrained with the character that this episode couldn't have used anything but a British accent. The way this episode puts the main characters in the background while the background and secondary characters speak remarks is absolute genius.
Maybe it's just a friendship problem, and it'll all be cleared up
yes.
in half an hour or so.
A bugbear is a scary, generic monster, much like a boogeyman. It can also refer to a pet peeve, giving us multiple layers to this joke.
But no pony's asked me to organize anything since Twilight came to town.
Amethyst Star is an actual background pony with virtually no fan-made characterization. This is hilarious, but is also not completely random because she was in fact an organizer for Winter Wrap-Up. Lyra and Bonbon are two background ponies that were commonly seen together, leading fans to ship them as a couple. Their depiction in this episode all but confirms this headcanon and seems to be intentionally teasing shippers.
You're my very best friend.
Bonbon's name is popular with fans, but toys
use Sweetie Drops
to her
is the original.
Sweetie Drops. This episode finds the perfect way to canonize both names.
Yeah, that's
Bonbon.
Genius.
It's Special Agent Sweetie Drops.
The long talks.
The benches
that
you sat on.
Lyra sitting on a bench is a fandom meme inspired by this brief shot showing her sitting in a very not pony-like fashion. It quickly became referenced in fan media and even started a brief phenomenon similar to planking. Lyra is also seen Lyra-ing later in the episode.
I've gotta go find a crowd to blend into.
Get it? Because she's a background pony?
Oh.
Extremely volatile! Without knowing what the trigger is, they could go off at any moment!
Dr. Hooves describes social media.
I'm Stephen Magnet!
Stephen Magnet is a fan-made name, but not just any fan-made name, because it comes from
YouTube
a time when full episodes
captions.
Were readily available on YouTube before Hasbro figured out what the internet was. And it was also at a time when YouTube rolled out a very broken caption transcription service, which never worked correctly. It was because of these two very dated things that the word Stephen Magnet appeared under
mm-hmm.
this character, and bronies have referred to him as such ever since. And now it's canon.
Yeah.
I had no idea you had such adventures together.
Cranky and Steven being longtime friends sounds odd at first, but only until you realize Cranky regularly traveled by river, and that's where Steven lives.
all these wedding songs are so standard.
That's why they're called standards.
And with just those two lines, the show makes Octavia a much more interesting character than somebody who likes stereotypical standard music. She can have a passion for her stringed instruments without being dogmatic about music like the posh cellist in any other cartoon would be. Vinyl and Octavia being roommates with different genre interests is a completely original idea the show came up with. Just kidding, it's also a popular fan-made headcanon turd canon, popularized by the legendary animation Epic Whoop Time, Musicians of Ponyville. Jumping the shark is a phrase to indicate a dramatic change for a show, usually for the worse and usually because the writers are out of ideas. Mm-hmm. The accuracy of this pun is up for debate, but its inclusion is hilarious nonetheless. Vinyl's base
a lot of the details I actually took from Bernie's React, because that's when I found them out.
Button Mash is a character who first appeared in the show but truly came to life thanks to Jan Animation and Shady Box.
Who is now off of YouTube.
Tarnished by Hasbro's harsh legal response
Button
forcing
Mash
Jan to take down his animations and never create fan content again under a threat of litigation. Thanks for ruining our sin removal streak, Hasbro. All hail the glorious Twilight Game. This freeze frame is actually in the episode, and it features some of the wonderful people who make the show happen.
Wait, so who is
not
it?
A brainless
I don't know.
Pet. He's just a really deep thinker. Hashtag save Hacy turnip truck.
What do you mean you left it on the counter?
I thought you were bringing it.
Celestia and Luna bickering like children despite being thousands of years old is hilarious.
Our friends have done it. They've defeated the bugbear.
The episode sticks to its background-foreground switch-up so well that we don't even see how the main six defeated the monster. It's all delightfully inconsequential.
You know those expensive imported oats you were saving for a special occasion? I cooked them up and ate them.
That's a reference.
Yeah. Why are they missing?
Well, I kind of
cooked them up and ate them.
I choose to believe this reference is intentional.
Yeah, it is.
Steven Magnet giving Cranky.
Unfortunately, it wasn't originally from that. It was from the Domus of Pets. Perfect.
Oh, Seth Mayer.
Derpy really is the best.
It's remarkable to me. How a story like Cranky's search for Matilda...
The fact they don't waste time bringing people up to speed is further proof this episode is for the fans, as if it wasn't obvious enough already. This moment made waves in the fandom when it happened, although looking back with all the changeling developments, it makes total sense. A notable companion of the Doctor is named Rose. I really wanted to add a sin here for the refusal to recognize Derpy's true name.
Yeah.
But if you think about it, it is probably a trademark issue preventing the word Derpy from being used, which means a reference to the fan-made characterization of Derpy loving muffins is the next best credit she could have received.
All right, then. I still wish they would have called her Derpy. I don't understand what exactly the legal issues have to be with that. All right, that was probably the best one so far. Have we got more? Yes. Got roundabout this time. Oh, just to be clear, that was they played Owner of a Lonely Heart in the Frenchers musical I just watched. Frenchers musical. I'm mumbling a lot today. All right. Anything wrong with Princess? Oh no. I think this is the worst episode of season five. I'm not sure.
Will dedicate this beautiful friendship statue.
But I'm gonna steal her glory and perform the reveal here and now. Hasbro, that's not very princess-like.
Yeah.
Tilt shift effect makes Castle look as small as the toy. Spike getting hit by a door cliche.
Right.
This is how Twilight always arrives at home.
Since the first episode.
One of her princess parties.
Can I count on you?
Cadence's misplaced trust in Spike is one of the show's more confusing recurring themes. Tree Trimmer would normally be using a wood chipper, but ever since the incident, Marge Gunderson wouldn't allow it while she's in town. This is the only tree that's not swaying, because otherwise it would be more difficult to animate Spike standing on it. How inconvenient that Canterlot is suddenly full of Chekhov's sneeze trees that specifically affect dragons on the same day the only dragon in Canterlot has an important task to carry out. Jackhammer, operated by magic, is both efficient and racist. Also, Worker randomly jackhammers next to a broken water main that should have been shut off long ago.
But there is no summit without Princess Twilight.
Actually, the summit is ongoing while she sleeps.
We're both supposed to give speeches in 5 minutes.
If something happens, it ain't my fault!
r/malicious compliance, the episode. Spike then spent the rest of the day crawling back up the stairs.
Princess Spike.
Roll credits. Marge Pony wears winter clothing to match her film character, despite it being inappropriate attire. Inappropriate for the season, of course, but also for not wearing pants.
Oh.
What am I supposed to do?
Well, neither of them are wearing pants.
Ask someone else in the chain of command?
Not sure which one's worse.
Another princess, maybe? Instead, Spike's first response is to lie his way through things, because he is terrible.
He is. This is a bad moment for Spike. Very shameful.
Why Ponyville, though? The other delegate is from Manhattan, and the event is hosted by Canterlot. Twilight's not the princess of Ponyville, but even if she was, this is a summit matter that has nothing to do with the small farm town. Did Spike find a way to reschedule the meetings off-screen, or were they scheduled to meet while Twilight was sleeping and Spike had to go in her stead anyway? You're supposed to cross your fingers while telling the lie, not shortly after.
Yeah.
Spike can't even lie right. Also, Spike is kind of terrible.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like anything bad happened.
Do you think A, the episode ends here? B, something good happens? Or C, something bad happens?
It's episode D, it becomes a terrible episode.
The Rube Goldberg series of disasters isn't even Spike's fault. Spike simply asked these players to move their game somewhere else, and he had nothing to do with this horrible shot. Likewise, the water main should have also been turned off long ago, so that's also not Spike's fault. The bottom of this tree disappears.
You get rid of the water!
Cadence, now is not the time for jokes. It's funny because Spike is useless.
Well, I don't know. What was
the
joke?
Wait, that's not funny at all. Caden stands in the road to watch the castle fill up with water the entire time this scene with Spike plays out. Meanwhile, at the other side of town, a massive water hammer wreaks havoc. Spike has 8 whole seconds to decide not to sneeze on the statue, but he does so anyway because he is terrible.
Wow.
Fancy Pants already knew about the water main and untrimmed trees, meaning he's partially responsible for not acting on this information before disaster broke out. Either that, or he just needed to know this to wrap up the episode.
This all could have been prevented.
I'm so sorry all this happened.
People who do bad things in bad faith then apologize only when it blows up in their face are the worst kind of people.
I'll not let Princess Twilight give Canterlot a bad name in the eyes of Equestria.
Now, let's form a lynch mob and literally storm her castle to restore our good name. Looks like Spike could have used the accessibility handrail all along. Twilight interrupts Spike's attempt to end it all.
Wow.
I had good intentions.
That's dark.
Spike's good intentions pave the road to Tartarus.
It just felt so good to have ponies caring about my opinions.
Equestria is doomed if social media is ever invented. They're standing here in front of the stage one moment, then the next they're on the stage and in front of a much larger crowd. Spike's attempt to put it back together utterly fails, even though he's not doing anything differently than the ponies, and he actually has fingers. The universe just hates Spike that much.
You know, the whole idea of the statue, when each of us plays our own small part, it adds up to something grand.
This episode isn't about Spike at all. It's about the statue. Spike was merely the unstable catalyst which brought back focus to the statue's meaning.
All right.
Furthermore,
well, there's something good he did then.
Not taking advantage of someone else's
really
position
on purpose,
suddenly
so.
Becomes an episode about working together and accepting people who unabashedly abuse power. Spike was forgiven by every pony, except for this guy who gives a flower called Dragon Sneeze to a dragon.
Yeah.
Since it wasn't really Spike's fault so many things went wrong, and he was never reprimanded for his horrible actions, and the lesson in the end had nothing to do with him anyway. What was this episode even about?
Yeah. It's terrible. It's really bad. Sleep deprivation. That's honestly my hell.
That happened.
Yeah, if only that didn't happen.
To every pony who plays their part, no matter how big or how small.
Alright. Next. Oh, man. Well, not as bad an episode, but still a bad episode next. Everything wrong with Poop Party. That's gross, actually. Why did I say that?
Everything's gonna be fine! Tell those butterflies in your tummy!
Pinky mistakes chest for tummy. The
yeah.
Yucks are a simple people. Whatever you do, don't startle them with flashy unicorn magic, or I'm going to needlessly teleport to them.
Wow.
Perhaps the Yucks are meant to be dumb, and dare I say, bullheaded, but this is a terrible way to introduce a recurring species. Their childish property damage-filled tantrum should not go unpunished, let alone rewarded. The ultimate party pooper. This one random nail serves no purpose. It is also moving on its own. Starlight Glimmer branded glue. Oh. Made from all natural equine dissidents.
I think they broke my record for most stuff broken in under a minute. They even broke the trophy.
Wow.
In fact, this joke was written by Brian Goldner himself. At least that's the joke I would have made if the credits hadn't confessed during the joke itself. Suspiciously stashed trophy.
All we have to do is show them how great it can be to have friends.
Is this before or after we convince them we're not a cult? Also, isn't it rather xenophobic to assume the Yeks don't have friends just because they're not ponies?
Presenting Animals! Yucky-Yuckistan style!
Cultural appropriation, the episode. Fluttershy disappears between shots. This is straight-up attempted murder, and every pony is ultimately okay with that.
Imported from the Crystal Empire to match your northern sensibilities.
Crystal ponies, yaks, them northern creatures are all the same.
You just make it up to them.
Yes, the ponies clearly have to make it up to the yaks for their bad behavior. Living relatively northernly, I can confirm this is exactly how snow works.
Snow is snow, no matter where it comes from.
Missed rhyming opportunity. Hyperventilation reads much better on script than it sounds in practice. Gummy expresses an emotion.
Oh.
This was 1 inch away from TVMA.
Oh.
Don't worry, I'll be back in time for the party.
Pinkie Pie discovers time travel.
This burden falls on my rump and my rump alone.
You could have just said back or shoulders, Pinkie. No need to make it weird.
Yeah.
How I can get there?
Come over here, lick my banana bread.
Pinkie Pie may not have many intelligence points,
also a
ponies
but her
luck skill
thing,
is maxed out.
Me and the boys are powerful tired because we was up all night counting cherries.
This is incredibly poor planning on her part. And no, this isn't a last-minute decision due to the train's schedule change since she was occupied during that time.
Oh.
The Yaks are going home!
They also just declared war.
Yeah. We declare war!
But that part's not important.
Yeah,
they may have just started a war.
Twilight has no reason to blame the Yak's terrible behavior on herself.
Wow! We were rescued midair by the Wonderbolts! And then they gave me a ride to Manhattan.
The Beatles!
We joined a traveling band, we played some shows here and there.
Deus Ex Machina, quickly followed by a distraction to help us forget that they were as good as dead.
Yeah.
Creative differences tore us apart. And that's when I knew to get back on with my journey to the Crystal Empire.
But the Crystal Empire is where the story left off. Cadence appears to be standing on the very top of her shoes.
No pony who's attempted this climb has ever returned.
They love Yak-Yakistan so much they decided to live there, right?
They didn't die.
Misplacing faith in others. But if what she said is true, and there's a good chance Pinkie Pie is going to die, how could she possibly be okay with this? She should send Spike instead. Pinkie's secret party planning cave doesn't make much sense considering her bedroom is on the top floor. Did they fall straight through the cake shop as well? Also, this carpet is conveniently smaller when the floor needs to open up. This joke might be funny if the show was consistently cartoony to such an excessive extent, but it's not, so it's not. It makes no sense for her to slide from here to here, down to here, then back up here.
Right.
Cherry Jubilee finished her delivery to the Crystal Empire and traveled to Manhattan faster than this episode dropped suspension of disbelief.
I was this close to helping Twilight.
This close. If ponies in the secret cave can be heard all the way up here, is it really a secret at all? A murmur up here has to be very noticeable down here.
It's notes for the party she wants to throw for her folks' 50th anniversary. But they ain't nearly that old.
This is the most we ever hear about a character's actual age, and it still tells us nothing.
She's already planning their 100th, too.
Oh.
500?
Watch out, Alicorns. The Pie family is also immortal and biding their time for a takeover. Wonderbolt recruitment is racially biased.
Oh. War. What is it good for? Increasing domestic manufacturing.
Yes, they're so cool.
That's a Bo Burnham joke. Oh.
Where's all the snow? Please tell me this is magical, sand-colored snow.
Oh, gross. Oh, I was kind of expecting a joke like that. However, I thought I was going to go the piss route. And this next one's the last one, I think. Yeah, many friends. This is a heartbreaking episode.
We hear Spike doing the dishes less than a second before he walks in. Hallway sinks. It's an Alicorn princess thing.
My dog.
Kind of funny, isn't it?
all these ponies coming to you for advice about friendship? Because you used to be famous for being such a bad friend.
Wow,
Spike.
Spike
is so desperate to shoehorn a new conflict before the opening theme that you'd swear he's on Hasbro's payroll. On that note, we have a chicken or egg situation here. Which came first? Twilight always being as anxious as a chicken, or Spike initiating her behavior during early childhood by egging her on? No other castles are shaped like a middle finger. It's a sin because it proves the other ones on purpose.
Come the other ones are just, shaped like
he
penises.
He said, hours later, as they arrive at the place he's discouraging her from going to.
M.A. Larson wrote this, I think.
The only logical place to start is at the beginning.
There is nothing logical about visiting her old home. This is just shameless nostalgia.
It's exactly how he left it.
Twilight never was very good at housekeeping.
Okay, it's hold up. I'm going to have to pause this. Okay, I'm back. Sorry, there was a bunch of stuff we had to do. But yeah, we can start this over. We can restart this, I mean.
Still open to the elements of harmony.
Good. Maybe now we can finally make sense of it. The present was red, now it's green. Then it goes back to red. Twilight reflects on her past.
I saw that.
She also reflects on this window, which would indicate the starry moonlit outdoors is darker than this unlit interior.
We're always over there visiting her.
Good explanation of why these background ponies are everywhere, but we still lack an official explanation for the duplicates, namely why no pony notices changelings.
But we just sort of figured you'd moved on.
I came to apologize.
For what?
Try to keep up, Minuet.
Yeah.
Minuet eats this donut, then moments later it reappears on her plate.
Sure, it might have stung a little bit when you ran off to Ponyville without saying goodbye.
But we only plotted your murder for a couple weeks, tops.
Remember when Lemonheart got her head stuck in that beaker?
Yeah, remember when you failed the class for not being able to tell beakers and flasks apart? Oddly detailed handle looks out of place. It must be really painful when cartoon characters get something in their eye.
Was she always like this? Well, she always was a little shy.
Great offense to the derogatory use of my name.
I remember he released that short long time ago.
Clip show alert! If you or a loved one has been exposed to recycled animation, you may be entitled to compensation. You know the horse tranquilizer is kicking in when your eyes turn to gelatin. Surprisingly loud door for a library.
Moon Dancer? Is that...
Wow.
The book lover who spent so much time at libraries and even lived in one for a while forgets basic library etiquette. Equestria's aversion to hands includes handrails.
Can I talk to you for a minute?
Wow.
Be as smug as you'd like, Twilight, but that was less of a this is a library shush and more of a go the buck away shush.
I haven't seen you in a while, and I thought it might be nice to catch up.
You'll have to pardon her disinterest in seeing old friends that are eager to chat. Moondancer has been sold essential oils one too many times. Most of the shushers aren't even reading. These library patrons had the same irritated reaction the last time some pony shrieked in terror. The funeral's on Tuesday.
Look, Twilight, twinkle, sparkle, whatever.
Every time you mispronounce a pony's name, a trademark lawyer dies of a stroke.
I've been studying a new studying tip.
I'm getting called again.
That's just procrastination with
Sorry about this. Alright, this ought to be the last time that happens, so let's go.
For steps. Twilight's cutie mark becomes shy and hides under her wing. The true revelation of the episode is that Twilight's been sitting on this property for 5 seasons.
Wow.
I tried friendship. And it's just not for me.
Twilight and Moondancer discuss religion. The problem with season 5 and onward
I've tried Jesus.
They don't hide fun stuff in the background anymore.
Yes, they must have gone back to Ponyville.
Thinking out loud to benefit an audience. Moondancer actually falls for this, despite knowing Twilight's been up to no good.
You've got to let me make this up to you.
You get 3 swings. No crippling, no killing, please. Twilight's rough edges and lack of a shadow strongly suggest
this
she
is
was
a
added
frightening
here
scene right here.
Credit to Moondancer. It takes a lot of skill to act alongside a CGI character.
You've got a lot of friends, Moondancer.
A fact which we just demonstrated by bringing in a family member and 2 old mares who also happen to like books.
Put it together, Twilight.
Come on, Twilight.
Out of context joke.
I'm glad you opened your big mouth. Hey, any pony up for a blast from the past? I have so many
The hub memory? The hub network? Oh no, I thought it was gonna be the hub network joke. Oh. Alright. And I don't think there's gonna be anything after this, this video right here, so I'm just gonna cut off because my phone's dying and. Yeah. Alright. So. Yeah, that was a great collection. It's good to get back to these and finally get caught up because I think because 10 of these, that's over 10, that's like 10 months that I have that, since the last time I did one of these. That slice of life one, that's probably going to be his best CinemaRisons video yet. Unless there's something else I'm forgetting that was even greater, but I don't know. This has got to be one of them. That was a pretty good one. 8 minutes? I think that might also be his longest one. Again, I could be wrong. Maybe the MLP movie ones were longer than not the MLP movie, but the Equestria Girls ones. Maybe the MLP movie. I don't know. I have to check. It's not really that it matters. But all I have to say is that's going to be one of his best CinemaRisons videos. As for the other ones, I thought they were all pretty solid. I don't think there is anything that really stood out much. Unless I go back to it and then rewatch it, then I'll remember some things that might stick out. I usually do that when I watch reactions of it. So. I don't really have much else to say, so hope you enjoyed the commentary. Got best, stay safe, have a nice day, and as always, goodbye.